If you are able, will you please stand? You may be seated.
In the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear God. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Jesus said, I am a good shepherd. I know his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom. Let us pray. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Show us now your grace, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are ended, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Let us now ask God to cleanse our hearts, to redeem our memories, and to renew our confidence in the goodness of God. Let us pray together. Holy God, you see us as we are. You know our inmost thoughts. We confess that we are unworthy of your gracious care. We forget that all life comes from you and that to you all life returns. We have not always sought or done your will. We have not lived as your grateful children, nor loved as Christ loved us. Apart from you, we are nothing. Only your grace can sustain us. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us. Heal us. Make us whole. Set us free from our sin and restore to us the joy of your salvation, now and forevermore. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Who is in a position of condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us, Christ rose for us, Christ reigns in power for us, Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Friends, know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Friends, know that in Christ Jesus we are God's Easter people. Thanks be to God. Will you stand with me and join me as we sing together in number 366.
Thank you.
make a habit of providing an opportunity for the family to address the congregation, to share words of remembrance. And over my years in ministry, what I've discovered is that people grieve in a number of ways, each one unique, each family unique. And quite frankly, the family said to a person, I don't think I can say a word. I'll get one word out, and then it will be, well, it'll be a puddle after that. And I certainly respect that. And I suspect you do too. But I also want to give the congregation an opportunity. If you have a remembrance of Jack that you would like to share with the family, there will certainly be a time to do that following the service downstairs. You are cordially invited to refreshments downstairs. But I would also extend to you an invitation now if you would like to share a story that involved you and Jack, or your family and Jack, or his family. I would invite you to share that. Are there stories?
Jack was my uncle, and he was my fun uncle, who took us to the farm and let us ride horses and gave us the chance to be responsible to take the cows from one pasture to another. And to go down and watch the chinchillas in the basement running from, you know, one cage to another. And that's what I always remember about him.
I have heard stories about chinchillas.
Yeah, almost. My earliest remembrance, I guess, or a good one, was when I started school. And he was a senior and I was a grader. And I never walked fast enough. He drove me along all the way to school, and that way I got there on time.
You got an education. Well, there you go. I drive a small British sports car that requires constant care. And Jack was very helpful when he made me realize that the engine in his Nash Metropolitan was the very same engine that was in my MG. So we were kindred spirits. Leaked oil like a sieve. Are there other stories?
I knew Jack from church, and I also knew one of his great grandsons, and he was in my class at school, and he always would ask me how he was doing, and I would tell him he's doing fine, you know, and he'd always greet me with a big hug. He was real good on hugs, and I guess that.
Yeah, I think you got that from Jack too.
Are there other stories?
Jack is sort of the passing, his passing is the end of an era. He was the last person in the congregation who actually they dug the hole, they sawed the boards, they pounded the nails, and built the main part of the sanctuary themselves. And so he is the last one to go who had a hand in that.
Would you like to preach the sermon? Because I was going to say that very thing. I think you ought to.
really was so fond of him, and that's why I'm here today, because I want to honor him, and he'll be missed very much.
That's right.
As a choir member, I think we all would agree that Jack was an inspiration to be a member of the choir. And for those of you that think you're too old to join a choir or leave the choir because you're too old, just think of Jack, because he sang with us, I think, last year at the end of the year, he was still singing with the choir. So you're never too old to enjoy and praise God through song.
Thank you.
return to you with loving and believing hearts. In the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, so that hearing the promises in Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the peace of your presence, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, who lived and died, and by the power of God was resurrected for us. Amen. We are gathered here this afternoon to participate in that final rite of passage for John Leroy Jack Buchholz. Jack enjoyed a long and full life until this past year, which frankly was a struggle for him medically. I could say that Jack died suddenly because he was intent on seeing his 100th birthday. And if discipline and determination were the sole measure of achievement, he would certainly be considered a success. Until recently, he would exercise daily, telling me you gotta use it or lose it. Jack died just a couple of years shy of that century mark, but he is now at peace, and we are here because of his influence in our lives. I will forever remember Jack as a kind and gentle soul. Neither loud nor forceful, Jack had a caring and cordial way about him that just drew people in. A true, gentle man, firm in his convictions, and yet winsome in spirit. Jack quietly served in this community with grace and generosity. Not one to draw attention to himself, he faithfully lived his life with unmistakable dignity and an integrity in matters both large and small. He played an important role in the church by supplying leadership and guidance for the congregation at St. John's. But he also rolled up his sleeves and engaged in everyday business of being a church. As Dr. McInnish points out, he could swing a hammer with the best of them. And he wasn't shy about rolling up his sleeves and engaging in the everyday business of being a church. This room is a testimony to that. Jack was the source of wise counsel and constant support. Jack was a presence that calmed and encouraged, a man who by his very company elevated others. Years ago, a wise mentor of mine gave an inexperienced pastor a valuable piece of advice. He said to me, after worship on Sunday morning, when you're greeting people at the door, you will hear both good and bad. Leave those words at the door, because some will complain because of the hymn selected or the sermon that was delivered. And others will give you praise because that's what they feel obligated to say. But leave all that at the door, both the good and the bad. Don't allow those words to measure your ministry. Jack was a faithful participant at St. John's. He didn't sit there, he sat right up there in that last row every Sunday. And after worship, he would greet me with the words, "We're so glad that you're here. Thank you." And I have chosen not to ignore those words, because that encouragement and support honestly flowed out of who Jack was. I take those words with me because they prompt me onward to do my very best. Jack remains a valued friend. Jack built a life that spanned nearly 98 years, and that's a long time. And through it all, he experienced the highs and lows that many people face, but not once did his love for his family flag or fail. He was completely devoted to you. His love was constant. It was apparent to all, and it was evident in his words and through his actions. For you, Susan, Melvin, Jackie, you are his children, and your lives were intertwined with his from the moment, in fact, before the moment you were born. He was the anchor, the foundation of your source of strength. Others of you who are here intersected with Jack in different contexts during the course of your lives, and no matter what your connection with Jack was, who you are will never be the same because of the man he was. Nearly 2,000 years ago, another person passed away, and his death was marked by his friends and family weeping and in fear. He was buried in a tomb and was turned over to the finality of death that would consume him, both his body and his memory. But death was no match for him. And through him, the entire course of history and the makeup of the cosmos changed. For in him, death's permanent hold on the world was broken. He rose from the dead and emerged from his guarded tomb. And as he appeared to his frightened followers, he gave them a legacy that would carry them through the perilous days and years ahead. Jesus filled them with new courage, with newfound strength, in order to face the trials and troubles that awaited them in the hands of a cruel world. And he gave them a promise, and he gave them a hope that in the end, unity will overcome estrangement. Forgiveness healed guilt. Joy conquered despair. Light would prevail over darkness, all because life has been defeated. Because life has defeated death. So, we are here today, heirs of Christ's promise and the hope that he gave to his original disciples. We stand, like his original disciples, heartbroken at the loss that we have suffered, sharing our grief at the loss of a beloved father, grandfather, great-grandfather, friend, and neighbor. He may have encouraged you to read, or fondly tend the garden, or lovingly serve in a thousand different ways. It may have been any number of these things and more that manifested Jack's passion for what was true and noble, but it was his unassuming strength of character and his steadfast love that will forge these things into the memories of a life well lived and the future of things to come. What matters is that the impact on your life is such that you have gathered here this afternoon not to say goodbye to him, but rather say till we meet again, knowing that we will gather once more at the dawning of the morning of the new creation. And in the meantime, his presence is as close to us as the air that we breathe. By the power of his Spirit, God's strength is there for us, encouraging us, sustaining us in the days ahead. We could live our lives without fear, trusting in that original promise given by Jesus Christ that in him, death is defeated and will remain so for all time. This is the promise of God. Thanks be to God. Eternal God, your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. Help us to turn to you with believing hearts. And in the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, so that, hearing the promises in Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the peace of your presence, through Jesus Christ our Lord. We read in Isaiah chapter 46. Listen to me, you descendants of Jacob, all the remnant of the people of Israel, you whom I have upheld since your birth, and have carried you since you were born, even to your old age and gray hairs. I am he. I am he who will sustain you. I have made you, and I will carry you. I will sustain you, and I will rescue you. And from the Paul's letter to the Church of Rome, chapter 6. When we were baptized into Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. If we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. If you're able, will you please stand with me? And joining the church across time and space, let us together confess what we believe by affirming the Apostles' Creed. Let us say together,
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He descended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. earth, and to earth we shall return. This you ordained when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with all your saints, where there is neither pain, nor sorrow, nor sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant.